Wakey, wakey! Hello. It's Vee Wild Soul. She's out with me for the weekend.
Not stuck.
She says she's not stuck, she's just resting. Had the afternoon, beginning of August 2016. And we're going to go somewhere up there.
Meet Pete Mindwiseman, aka Maverick Outdoors, and we're going to make our way up that way and take a few shots and take Vee out for a nice little canoeing weekend and have some nice weather. Cop that.
So we're going to find a river bank and camp up. So we've stacked up the canoes and just walk over to our pitches for the next two nights. And there's Vee, she survived her paddle, did really well.
I loved it, it was really good. Good teacher.
Yes.
Good teacher.
Oh no, well actually what I was, I didn't mean to say yes, I meant to say, because I was thinking of an answer and I was thinking yes, not yes, good teacher. Yes, it was really fantastic out on the water.
Yes,
but.
Too.
But it's Vee's set up. Got a, what is the tarp, Vee?
It's Rab Sil Nylon Sil.
I was lightweight jobby.
Yeah, very lightweight.
Right.
It's my good old trusty one here.
It really is nice. It's got a nice sort of sheer feel to it. And Vee was saying a little bit earlier that she's tested it in really sort of heavy weather terrain and it's really done the job considering how lightweight it is. Little sleep system over there. Great, she was going to bring, I said to her to bring just sort of maybe a few litres of water because I was going to bring a 10 litre jerry, but she's brought her own. So re's up. Set up the other side, in a 10 litre jerry can, but it was because Vee brought her one, it just gave a bit of spare water, so I used that little towel over there to give myself a little bit of a douche over because I got quite perspiry, so it's just nice to have a sort of fresh wash over besides using wet wipes. So that was good, so we got plenty of water to see us through without having to sort of scrimp and save. And what Vee has very kindly done, she's just given us a few hors d'oeuvres. So we've got, as she's calling them, and they're, what are they, Primula type soft cheese on
well,
bits
very
of
grand.
Biscuits?
Well, that's blobs of rather melted cheese on old biscuits.
Oh, right, okay.
No, dog biscuits.
And then some, we're going to have that with some vine leaves wrapped rice. So, a bit of carbohydrate before we actually get the campfire going. And there's plenty of stuff in there. I've got stuff stored in the MSR tin. I've got loads of stuff in the 3 litre billy can cum kettle and then loads of food in that bag. Vee's bag over there with bits and pieces. So we've got plenty of scoff for the next 3 days because it's like Friday, afternoon, evening. We've got all day Saturday and a lot of the day Sunday. So we need plenty of food. That did it. Spot on.
It's quite a good trip, the old Vee thing.
What I'll probably do is unwrap that ground sheet and then use that as a bag as well for any other small bits. And relaxing, just leaning against this tree. Yeah, I think she's gone now. Yeah, I'm bringing all the heavy stuff. Yeah, you carry on. Oh no, she's got the heavy stuff.
Why do you want this then, sir?
About 300 metres to your left.
Alright, so I'll just keep going, sir. Okay. Don't worry about me, sir.
You see, you have to spark up the relationship with outdoorsy people in the right way. I'll put hairs on your chest. You've got to have a bit of fun in the great outdoors. Right, I think I better go over that way and follow her with some of the wood I've got here in the ground sheet, and just using it as a holdall device. Just fold over the end, roll it up, and then just carry it as you saw me carrying earlier. So let's get this fire going.
Making up for the fact that V was transporting half the forest with both her arms. So I said, it's all right, I dig hole.
So it's come up to about 9:30. Some of the wood over there, got plenty of wood for tonight. And between me and V, dug out the fire pit, and that is not only just aromatic, it's got a nice smell to it, but that's rearing up like as if we've got some sort of gas flue underneath it. But I guarantee you that is real flames from wood, not some special effects pyrotechnic bit of kit newly on the market. Very mesmerizing. We're going to be using that, getting some coals to actually go on the recess, which is just in there, that little bit. And then when we get some bigger stage wood, 3 and 4 stage wood, there's some big bits there actually, we'll put the coals underneath that recess where the grid is going to go on top. And then we've got some pork belly strips marinated in maple syrup, and a special spicy fresh vegetable to be cooked up on the coals in my saucepan. Vegetable medley, and then mixed with rice. I feel like that's some sort of advert on television telling you this isn't just, and I won't say the two letters, food, but this is Maverick Outdoors and V Wild Soul food. Bring it on. So I've just put the grill frame over the recess, and once that has burnt through a bit with those bigger bits of wood, just break them up and the coals will go underneath to cook these pork belly strips, which will lay over that grid. And then in this saucepan, the MSR 1.6 litre you've seen, I think you've seen me use this about 3 or 4 times now. What's going to go in there is going to be this concoction of carrots, runner beans, green peppers, red peppers, onions, mushrooms, seasoned with coriander, mixed spice, garlic, ginger, and that will go in the 1.6 litre saucepan over the coals. And for the carbohydrate element, this is pre-cooked rice. So you've seen me use this type of thing before as well. Microwavable, already cooked. You can see the colour of it underneath, looks really tasty. And that will mix in the saucepan when we serve it up for me and V to have our scoff for tonight. But then the piece de resistance. Those two little sachets, dessert. Look at that. Fresh fruit salad in a bonded and handmade little vacuum pack bag made to size. It's got peaches, black grapes. Going through the recipes, I don't know, it makes me laugh as well. Green grapes, orange, apple, and what are called donut nectarines or donut peaches. And then instead of using the tub of custard that comes in a little pot, I'll just put it in there, squeeze some of the air out and just sealed it. So we've got a sachet, one each, desserts. Yummy. So we've got the pork strips on the go. Turned them over once so you can see they've cooked and sugary fired from the maple syrup marinade on the top. So they've got about another 15-20 minutes to go. and then the veg is in the saucepan. But I've got a new toy, a wooden spoon, which was kindly given to me. As you can see, it's got some little fancy presenting ribbon on it, and V made that, handmade it for my birthday. So I've got a new bit of kit, and as you can see from where my hand is, my knuckles are not getting roasted at the same time now from using the small normal dessert spoon. So get in. That spot on that is nice and rustic and all bushcrafty and outdoorsy to stir the old food. I'll put the lid back on that in a moment so the heat pressure sort of builds up and cooks while stirring it now and then, so it doesn't scorch and burn on the base of the saucepan, which it's not doing. But V's just put some extra bit of firewood on those embers on the other side, and she's going to be doing some bannock. So we've got to nibble on later on if we want, or for breakfast tomorrow, so at least it's cooked up fresh. So she's going to be getting on that in a moment. So we've got a multifunctional cooking unit. Pork belly strips on the other section, veg cooking. And then soon to be bannock roasting on those coals. Bring it on.
I've made a sort of thickish dough in this cup, and what I'm going to do is transfer it to, if Pete can put the torch on here, this is the top of the zebra billy cam, I don't know what that was, but stick in there, and I've just put a tiny bit of coconut oil, organic coconut oil in here, which I've melted, so that's going to act as the base, it will stop the dough sticking. And I'm going to rest it up against the fire, which you will see in a minute. Before and after. It's going to be a big sodding. Let's put that there. Are you filming me?
Mm.
Oh shit. Please don't want this bit. You can see in principle what I'm trying to do, but I'm trying to cheat. And use. Okay.
Looks alright from where I'm sitting.
Yeah, it's gonna be fine. I just need to really put it into a ball without touching it. Which is kind of a bit of a challenge. Come on, tip I flip it over. Maybe not. Can I do this with that?
That looks alright, yeah.
There we go. If I pat that down, because I've got the greasy side now. It's okay.
That coconut oil looks as if it does a better job of allowing you to sort of spread that out and take its shape than normally greasing up a pan.
I agree.
It's like as if you've just put something you'd expect on a non-stick pan, if that makes sense.
Exactly. And that, I mean, I've got to wash all that out. So that's kind of how it's going to sit.
Spot on.
And then I'm just going to get a stick. And then put it. A little bit hot, so I'm going to probably kind of rest it, or for now put it there. It's not quite hot enough. Yeah, I'll have to get another stick.
Or if you wanted to, you could bank over some of that, the soil from the fire pit, closer to it if you wanted to.
Yeah, it's
alright.
Like
so then the heat from the flames, without it being direct, will actually start to bake it.
Yeah.
Right.
It's not. It's almost. It'll take a good 40 minutes.
Right.
You just don't want it to. Well, you'll see it start to go brown. It's not quite hot enough here. But when that starts burning through, it will be.
Yeah. Got it. Scoff to the max. Not long to go till I had the rice in that little magic pot down there. So there's V.
I've died and gone to heaven.
It's pretty tangy, isn't it?
This was just the best. Thank you, Pete.
More than welcome. Welcome to my world of overeating.
I'm trying to keep up with you.
Those pork belly strips are just right, you know, they're tender. I'll wait till you bite into that. It's so tender.
Oh.
And just sort of melts in your mouth. And normally that meat, it can be sort of a bit sort of tough. But cook it just nice, the right sort of temperature and at the right time. And that was actually perfect. Spot on, isn't it? Then, all right, so my portion does look a little bit bigger because I'm eating out of the saucepan. But that's just the convenience of not using a bowly plate. So we're ready to tuck into that. So just giving a sort of simple example of, if you do sort of use a bit of creative thought, it don't just have to be noodles and an OXO cube. The world's your oyster, really. Especially if you've got time to sit down in good company, it's worth sort of prepping the food. But the next little bit of scenario I see is, once we finish this, we'll be eating the dessert, so. But we need to sort that out first. Yummy. Good morning, it's now Saturday at about 9:30. We had a little chinwag after we had all that elaborate wild camp food, which was really nice. We had a good old chat sitting around the campfire. Hung the old kettlebilly can up and had a brew and some biscuits and just chatting on that. And V settled about just gone 1 o'clock in the morning. And myself, I just set up a security perimeter with an alarm and some fishing line, and then settled myself about half hour potting around tidying up. Instead of bringing some of my kit under the tarp here or down my foot end, I left my kit outside, and the tarp I used to carry some of the firewood when we went collecting it yesterday, I actually reversed it round the other way. So the green surface that was on the outside that wasn't touching the wood was on the inside covering it, because it's a bit silver reflective on the outside. And plus as well, if we'd had a sort of sunny morning, as you can see it's a bit overcast today, but if it'd been very sunny in the morning, at least the lighter colour would have reflected the heat a little bit more, because obviously the food bag was in there. So the cooler the food, obviously the better the situ for all the bits and bobs that are in the food bag. It might sort of clear up a bit later on, but of course with the forecast weather, it wasn't necessarily predicted to be sort of maybe this fresh. So of course that meant the weather could have changed. Well, we might have had a little bit of rain, so at least that would have been protected, which is the stove, the water, jerry can, my food kit bag, all the bits and pieces that you saw out on the ground from or being away from the tarp. So I didn't have to actually bring it under the tarp, as I brought the extra, the tarp I'm sleeping under rather, but the little green tarp, because I brought two of them. One is my base floor,
on the Mubasha tarp, and then the other one, which were used specifically for the wood carrier, then it had a dual purpose.
So yeah, I didn't actually put my don me old softy trousers and jacket on until I'd been laying down for about maybe an hour and a half. I sort of dozed off a little bit and just had my shorts on and this sort of lightweight. It's army issue, it's like known as a tropical shirt, but I re-dyed it. I actually dyed it in black just to take away the sort of military look. Obviously it's still got the camo pattern to it, but it sort of just made it a little bit less sharper in sort of like military camo look. And I just had that on for a good hour and a half. I sort of dozed off a bit, didn't even have the buff on, because I was still quite sort of warm. Although V was sort of tucked up in her sleeping bag, I just wasn't sensitive to the sort of coolness. And I knew I'd have felt sort of hot and stuffy if I'd have put this on straight away. So it wasn't until about a good hour and a half after settling and laying down under the basha that I actually donned this on. Because if I'd have put this on as soon as I settled, I just would have felt all sort of hot and flustered. So I thought, yeah, I'll just wait until the chill factor kicks in a little bit and then put it on. Better to sort of fall asleep feeling comfortable than waking up needing to put your sleep kit on, rather than put it on when you don't feel comfortable wearing it or getting in the sleeping bag, and that keeps you awake because you're too sort of warm, you know. So method to me madness for last night's kip, and it was okay. Once I settled, I was sort of like out for the count really. But an important start of the day, V has kindly made me a brew, which I'm going to put two little sachets of milk in and probably add some sugar, and get that down my throat, and then sort of do a bit of tidying up and get ready to make breakfast. Oh yeah, there's a little cramp ball, King Alfred's cake, that was stuck to a tree that V kindly said, here, I'll put that in your pocket, while we were collecting wood yesterday. As you probably know, you put a spark on the centre of that bit, that's the surface that was actually connected to the tree, and when you break it off, there's sort of like a fibrous texture which will take a spark really easily, and you can use it as tinder to start your fire. And that, I mean, the size of that one would sort of stay glowing for a good sort of half hour.
Oh, is it all right?
Yeah, it's all right.
Yeah, I'm just going to understate it, yeah. It's scrummy yummy to the max.
I might make the canoe sink now.
Okay, it's about just gone 5 o'clock in the afternoon on Saturday, and we've come out with two unloaded canoes per person and just having a nice leisurely paddle. You see the sun's cascading through the little ripples of the water and just literally just chilling. Nothing sort of a mission, just sort of paddling, stopping, taking in the vibes of the waters. Looking at the wildlife, seeing the different types of boats, and we're going to sort of have a little trip now back upstream, sorry, back downstream, and a little bit of sightseeing. So, come this way, folks. U-turn, boat number 6, your time is up. There's V, doing a bit of paddling, totally incensed by all the wildlife. Just hanging around here in the sunlight, glistening off the water before another vessel comes along. There's nothing coming either way, so we can just meander nice and relaxed. But we're going to make our way up there. Okay, so we came back from the paddle. We were out for about, I suppose, just over an hour. It's just nice and relaxed. We had a chance to take some footage and enjoying the outdoors, being in the canoe, being on the waters and what have you. So that was really great for her to sort of get out and really enjoy it. And the weather was really nice today as well. She's just prepping some more wood to get the fire going. So we're going to cook some food, but we replaced some calories. Oh, this is simple as it is. It's so tasty and so Moorish. Really simple. We had some little mini cracker things earlier with some soft cheese that you like to squeeze. It's like in a big toothpaste type tube. And then we just got these oat cakes with the cheese that are in these sort of wax containers. And buttered them. But it's really nice. As simple as it is, it's just so tasty and novel. I've eaten this sort of thing outdoors. Absolute quality. So replacing a few calories just to keep us going, and then we're going to knock up some scoff on the campfire, and V there is all ready to get the rest of the day going while I just sit back and order around.
My turn to cook. So burnt offerings tonight.
So with the old MSR 1.6 litre saucepan cum fry pan with a lid, I can sort of do the Russian doll effect. This is a saucepan, anyone following my vids has actually seen it before, but I normally put my little 1 litre kettle in the middle there, but you can put all bits and pieces in there. I just brought this extra as a sort of serving bowl if I needed it, and then an extra little saucepan in there. So again, it Russian dolls, all sort of fits in. Lid goes on, and of course the handle goes over and then clips and clasps. But we've got the kettle on the boil, ready for a brew. Container that I use for tea and sugar for a good sort of 3 days. Brew ready to go in there, and come across these recently at the pound shop. About 24 of these. It's actually condensed milk, and you can tell by the label of what make it is. And it's actually but full fat milk, so it's not sort of watery like some of these little pouches or tubs are. So 3 of them will be just about the right volume. Bringing what would normally be about a half a litre tin, about the size of my hand. So I sort of calculated the all-in-one coffees that I'd be drinking and sharing with V over the weekend, and also she bought some bits and pieces as well. Glancing over there, because that's where her kit and food is. And so I thought, for what it's worth, I'd get a little collection of those little tubs of milk. So 3 of those are going, ready for about half a dozen cups of tea, besides the actual all-in-one coffees. So that's boiling now. So we're gonna have a nice brew, and you might have heard the crackling in the background. V's got the old fire going, ready to cook up our main scoff in a little while. So it's a nice chill time, outdoors, camping on a riverbank, after a nice little paddle in the canoe. So we just cooked up some pasta. Well, not we, V did. Some pasta twirls, some sort of savoury mincy packet stuff. Put that in. And now she's eating hers. Scoffing to the max. Really nice. It's nice to have a carbohydrate as well, so I think our carbohydrate window after that little bit of paddling. And there's my one in my little recess bowl that normally goes in the 14 centimetre zebra billy can, which you saw me earlier feature it in the little sort of Russian doll effect in my MSR and my just over a litre saucepan. So we're now going to stuff this down our throats. Moving it on, famous last words. Okay, the piece de resistance, the dessert, the fruit salad and custard. We didn't have it last night, kept it in the shade, in the cool bag. It's as if it's been left in either a cold larder or sort of bit of fridge. It's not freezing cold, but it obviously has definitely not perished. But we're going to have one of these each, and we're going to put it...
It's a gallon each.
Yeah, this whole catheter of... But we've got one of them each. And there's V's one, and we're just going to pour it in there and just have this homemade prepared in the old sealed bag sachet dessert.
Is that carrot in there?
Yeah. Oh, I've been sussed. I wanted to put a vegetable in there, see if you'd suss it out. Nice one. So I just poured that out of the sachet. Look at all that. Just a quick recap. Sliced back black grapes, green grapes, bits of orange. Peach, which actually came out of the little long life pots, but all the rest of it's fresh, and some donut nectarines and a pot of custard. But the liquidy bit is actually the juice out of the peach pot. So, and by the sounds of it, V's definitely enjoying hers. God, if that slurping's anything to go by. Oh, yeah. Okay, so it's coming up to about 10:15 on Saturday night. It's really mild. Bit of a freshness to the air, but there's no chill factor, so it's really nice. No breeze. Maybe the odd distant aircraft. Lucky enough, this weekend, we haven't really heard much of a flight path. So maybe because the weather's been really clear, so the flight path has been further away, which tends to be the case when I've been to these sort of locations before. So that's all good stuff. But we've got the fire now dying down a little bit. As you can see, been sitting, standing around the fire, just talking a few life stories, bit of a chin wag to the ambient flames and the bit of warmth. So it's not that cold, just a very light freshness, which is really nice. But we're going to basically just chill for a little bit longer. We're planning tomorrow, the weather's going to be about sort of virtually the same as what it was today. So we're planning on going for a little bit of a longer trip. Once we strike down camp, we'll vacate the location and then go for an afternoon's paddle a bit of a longer distance tomorrow. Going to show V a few other sights, experiences on the river. And then late afternoon we'll sort of paddle back to put in, which will eventually be the end of a really lovely weekend. Canoeing, wild camping, campfire cooking, two burner stove cooking, nice selection of food whilst enjoying the great outdoors, waterway style. Priceless. Oh, it's a nice, mild Sunday morning. Same start as yesterday, Saturday morning, really. The cloud cover's very high, it's quite sparse. It's just a little bit overcast. Very, very light freshness to the air. You can see the leaves are hardly moving at all.
And once again, a bit of pillow talk to start the day. But talking of pillow talk, literally,
pillow headspace literally being the inflatable pillow. But then on what I've done before, so it changes, you know, different times, whatever's convenient to use. But a dry bag that's got some sort of change of clothing, which goes in the bigger dry bag, but to stop it sort of sliding, which I've brought up before about sometimes when you use a few things and then before you know it, you wake up during the night and what's woken you up is because your head has changed position. But this bag I used as a sort of a wedge on the ground sheet, which is quite heavy, which has got some of these bits and pieces, like if we couldn't get to this pitch and we had to go elsewhere, then I always take a backup set of sectional basher poles. So if we can't use uprights like this on that tree, and because I'm in the canoe, I don't have to really worry about sort of bulk and weight, so I'll put whatever I can in there. So that's virtually my shelter kit. But back to the point being that I use that as a wedge, that bag sort of like butted up against it, and then with that pillow, and that still kept me at that sort of angle where I like my head to be.
And again, depending on where I am, what I've got will depend on how I sort of improvise. So it's never the same pillow system each time. It's whatever I've got at that particular time to actually make the headrest. But more important issues.
The first brew of the day, which V kindly made for me.
So to get a bit of hydration sustenance to start the day. Cheers.
Just a bit of a bullet point on my hardware stuff. My sort of quite thick hide, really sort of good for collecting wood, messing around with a fire pit, you know, taking coals out, whatever you can see. I mean, I've had these, I think I've had these for nearly 2 years now. But I made an eyelet, and again, I've featured this before, but for those of you that maybe haven't seen it, I fixed two eyelets on the wrist cuff of the gloves, as you can see, one on each bit, so then I can thread the carabiner and actually fix those to my belt. Then my Jacklaw prototype before Sandy of Jacklaw Knives went big time. He sent me one of these for reasons that I've gone into before when he first started out, and he started to contact me first of all when he got into YouTube and what have you. So this is quite sort of got sentimental value for me as well, but I always have that besides maybe any other knife, sort of like really nice traditional bushcraft. And as you can see, traditional bushcraft knife. So one of Sandy's prototypes, which he kindly sent me in the early days. So that. This LED torch lantern, the torch is on the end of the lantern there, so you press the button sort of a couple of times, there's a torch, turn it off, there's the LED light, which is resonates quite a lot of light, and it's got sort of a lever stand on it so you can adjust. It's also got magnets if you're using it sort of for any mechanical repair on your car or where the magnet is relevant to actually sort of fix it and sort of hang it. And then of course you've got hook on the top. That was kindly given to me by my son. I think it was a Christmas present this year, just gone. Knee pads and the little envelope holder where when I dismantle the tripod, the three legs come in three sections and it unscrews, where the three top ends of the legs will screw into that sort of circular boss where the chain hangs down, and of course then that's over the fire as it was over the fire pit last night. All goes into nice and compacted in that little bag. So yeah, literally all good stuff. And once again, there's V's pitch and setup where she got out of the old DOS bag. Just a closer view, so that was a sleep system, really simple. Nothing necessary to sort of overprotect on the ground. And just really nice, basic, simple, straightforward. Always handy, a
especially if you've got a bit of space between the ends of the corners of the uppermost part of the tarp. As you can see there, I've got my hand towel that's left there last night from drying. I had a bit of a douche over with some nice, fresh, cool water after we've been for a paddle. So when you've got a few lines around, you can use them to sort of air your sleep kit or drying stuff, or just airing stuff in general, and just sort of things to hang lightweight, nothing too heavy, so it doesn't then affect your shelter or droop it down. And the same as V could with the right hand end facing her basher, where she's fixed her line to the tree. So sometimes when you're able to sort of get that sort of fixing, you've got even more practical space for admin things and just to hang stuff and garrot your neck and throat because you forget it's there or trip over it. So about coming up to 10 o'clock Sunday morning, there's a bit of life on the river. Heard some double oar speed rowers go by. There's one small boat going to come by in a little while now, just hear it in the background. So yeah, I mean, this sort of weather brings people out, and quite rightly so. It was busy yesterday, lots of canoeists. I think there was a batch of about six people, some in K1s, K2s, a couple of inflatables, all a group of people that obviously did a little flotilla and out together. So that was nice to see, we passed them as well. So this weather brings out people this time of year, especially when it's nice and clement, just like it's brought me and V out. I'm really glad that I could bring V out this weekend. We've talked about it for quite a while, and it's something she wanted to do. She's done a bit of canoeing and kayaking before, but not anything for a very long time, sort of like incorporating the wild camping and what she already does, but with a waterway sort of version, you know. So yeah, it's really good that she could come out with us for the 3 days, 2 nights. And because I'm sort of so enthusiastic about it, because she had been for a long time, and then of course me, literally me, as in Emmy, Maverick Explorer, once I got all those made up, she was really interested because obviously I got close contact with her, being in a sort of group of people that regularly go out together, sort of maybe a couple of times a year. So we've been in close contact, and so she said, oh, you know, great. She was really enthusiastic about it, you know, really glad that I'd sort of started the project. Then of course when I said to her, oh yeah, sometime you'll have to come out with me. So once she could arrange some spare time, it fell into place this weekend, which was great. The timing of it was fantastic to be able, especially for sort of the first time, to sort of the weather being clement. I mean, all weather's all terrains, and she's the same as well, you know, it doesn't matter, as long as you've got the right kit, just go out anywhere, anytime. But of course when the weather's clearer, you've got less things to have to consider with your logistics, and it just makes it so easy and relaxing, as you've seen so far, for us to go out on the water. So it's been a great experience for her, and it's really nice that I could sort of share it with her and bring her into my world of the canoe and the waterway. So yeah, all good stuff, really pleased about that. And aside from the jokes of force feeding my reputation of like three course trail food meals and different recipes and all that sort of thing, talking of that, I think she's had some porridge because she was up just a little bit before me and was a bit peckish, so I think she's got a portion of that for me. And I've also got for convenience this time for breakfast, a tin of all day breakfast and a bread wrap as well, so I'll probably have some of that and some of the porridge that she's got, so it'll be a two-course breakfast for me. But prior to knocking up some Sunday morning scoff, just a quick other bullet point. What I did last night is, because my battery power was going down on the phone, because I did a bit of uploading sort of social network pictures of the event of the weekend, so of course that took the battery power down a little bit, and as you well know, using the RAV power lantern that sort of pulls out, use it as a hanging lantern or as a torch at the end here, but I used it to charge the phone last night rather than leave it till first thing in the morning and have to wait for it to be charged. Before I settled last night, I actually put it on charge, as you can see there, rested it so it was safely off ground level on my dry bag, which has got other bits and pieces in there as well, the other small dry bag that I use in the pillow behind me. And then just use one of my lightweight t-shirts just to sort of like insulate over the top, because as you're probably aware, the colder it gets, although it wasn't cold last night, the warmer the battery or any battery system and the way that you're charging any bits of kit, the warmer it is, the more efficient it is. But of course if you've got a contrast of temperature changing, it can sort of start to deplete the charging process, or even sort of deplete the battery of whatever source that you're charging from.
obviously that's going to have some sort of dilemma in the sort of autumn or winter months, you know, or early spring. But I just thought, right, I could have just left it like that. But I thought, no, it can be even more efficient, just to insulate it a little bit. My tactical pouch, which I always have around my waist, which will have a personal ID, my wallet, a pen knife just in the base there. So in that pouch is my keys, where my finger is on that zip, and my wallet, ID, bits of money, backup, you know, things that you always want to have on your person. Then the front
is where the phone slides in and secures with a zip over the top of it.
So when I settle for the night, or I'm not doing anything for a long time with the phone, it will actually stay in that pouch, and I would have literally left it there. But then on the other part of the belt is this pouch, which is a pouch, you might have seen this before as well, off of another waist bum bag, fanny bag, which actually had the sort of main part of the pouch, and then this was fixed to the front of it, as you can see, with this sort of Velcro popper stud loop, which I've actually threaded the belt through. This little pouch would normally thread over the belt of the matching waist bum bag, so I can separate this, and it's just the right size to put my stills camera and the camera that I'm filming with. So I'll have that on my person, on my waist at all times when I'm ever going away from base or they're not within arm's distance. This will actually stay around my waist at all times. Head torch that I've been using more recently. It's a bit of a cheapo really. I think it's about, I don't know, about a fiver off of eBay. But it's sort of like got a telescopic lens that moves forwards and backwards. You can just see it's only by about not even 10 millimeters, and you pull it forward and it narrows the beam and you can sort of see it a longer distance, whereas when you pull the lens back it widens the beam, so it's for shorter distance where you've got more space in the light compared to more of a sort of a funnel direct beam when you extend it to see what's at a further distance. And it's got, when these batteries are sort of like new, it really has a nice strong beam and it can really focus, so I could sort of like shine it sort of over to those bushes, and if there was a pigeon, say a bird or something in the top of the brow of that tree, it would be really easy to see due to the light beam coming from this head torch. So as you can see, I've taken down, I don't really need to air them, I just put my sleep kit, softy trousers and softy jacket on my tarp line just to get them out of the way, because I'm not wearing them again, so I could have just put them straight in those two little bags there, the jacket and the trousers. But so I just put them on the line for convenience, get them out of the way while I was getting up, and then I'll just pack that away. But what I tend to do, I'll only deflate my mat, sleep mat, about halfway, fold it in half, so I've got that while I'm working under my tarp as a knee support, whilst this knee pad I can actually put back on the stall seat, or actually put it on the ground away from the ground sheet if I'm kneeling down elsewhere. So I'll be doing that little bit of admin later, packing all that stuff away, but now I'm going to get some food on the go. Okay, so when I'm away from sort of base or a lot of kit, I'll always have this attached to my person on my belt, as you can see the loop there, with lots of bits and pieces, fire steel, a couple of torches, whistle. But then the military issue, army, I think US Army issue, this is bomb-proof, it's only little, but the tin opener, again, you would have seen me use this actually quite a long time ago, but I featured it a few times, to open that tin of all-day breakfast, and then I'm going to either put bits of it in the wrap, dip it in. But of course, you can see the butter there, where I've just buttered it, and then we've got two mugs ready for mine and V's brew, so I'm going to get it on the brew. One of the burners to do the billy kettle, then the other burner to just heat up the pre-cooked all-in-one breakfast. But what I've done with the sausages, they're sort of about 4 inches long, so they heat up quicker. I've just cut them into sections, so it just heats up quicker and just easier to consume. Buttered bread wrap at the ready, using the inner surface of the lid of my food box as a plate. So I always try and keep that sort of like clean if it's going to have food contact. So I'm ready to pack into my 100 litre, although that isn't the full capacity that I'll be using today. Potential for 100 litre dry bag, and in it is going to be softy jacket, softy trousers, microfiber towel that I didn't use, but you know, if you get sort of grubby and dirty, you need to have a douche over and a wash. My wash kit in there, a gel soap, flannel, toothpaste, toothbrush, first aid kit, mozzie net I didn't use. It's a sort of pyramid shape that you can hang like that either side, so sort of a pyramid shape like that, and sort of covers over you with you sort of laying across like that. Waterproof jacket, which will go on the top so it's easy access. Waterproof trousers, and then a smaller bag here for smaller clothes sundries, so you know it's separate from all the loose stuff that's actually going to go in there. So I'm going to pack that away, but I'll fold this up into sort of a quarter of the size and then have that at the base of the 100 litre dry bag. Just one extra thing about the self-inflating mat, I could actually sort of roll it up and have it as the wall inside there, but this isn't conducive for it. It just makes it all awkward. It all crumples about and folds over. So I'm just going to fold it so it's that shape, but the valve, so it's protected, rather than it actually snag and actually get sort of affected where this could get damaged, I always get the valve and I turn the corner in, and then when I fold that over, it's protected rather than being on the outer edge where it could get snagged and so over a period of time damaged. So that's the method to my madness. I actually fold the valve inside. So we struck down camp, that's where my basher was. Our living space for the 3 days, two nights. Leave no trace. The ground is exactly as it was. So also was the fire pit. Leave no trace.
Looking good?
And a touch. It's probably down to this being in the cool area. The air has shrunk a little bit.
Oh, right.
Nothing to write home about. It's about 10%.
V's patiently waiting. She put in first. Just sort of having a nice little relax floating around. And we're off to do just a little bit, about an hour's leisurely puzzle before we actually go to put in and finish the day off. Notice how relaxed she is. Spot on. So as you can see, we're out in the waters and we've just come slightly off. We're going upstream, but we've just come to a little backwater where V's just taking a few nice little arty shots. It's a totally different world down there. Lots of overhang, weeping willow. It's about a mile and a half long before it then goes into another stretch of another river. But it's a typical backwater stream where it's really narrow. So you've got to have your wits about you and the right technique, because the stream will take you. It's about 5 miles, about 8 knots. So if you're not sort of versed to manoeuvring in short, narrow spaces, you can scupper and get caught underneath the overhang. Just to my right of the canoe, sort of over that side, is a private house overlooking the River Thames, and they've got a garden party, so give them a bit of privacy, although we've got the right of way, right of navigation to come down here. I've actually just come into this backstream I was just talking about, doing my famous one-handed paddle. But I'm hardly needing any momentum from the paddle at all. And you can see I'm moving. And it's literally the stream that's taking me. But I'm going to go down to about that little bit of overhang of willow, and then I'm going to do a U-turn and come back. But you can see that narrow space just there. So I've been down here a number of times, but V's not quite used to it, so I don't want to be over provident. But all the wildlife, kingfishers are down here. But then looking back up this stream, then there's V. So I've just come out of that stream. V's just looking at all the vegetation. It's really sort of arty. I said to her there are probably loads of things that she'll come across that will really interest her that she's not sort of maybe imagined that she'll find. And just looking at something like the undergrowth under the water, you know, that's another aspect of the world of paddling on the rivers. And all right, so we've got a little bit of air traffic going over, but after a while you don't take any notice of it. And now that sun's really come out nice and bright. Dragonfly. I saw it hovering. Right over there. So we've come into this little backwater and we've double parked, moored up against this nice little bit of grass bank. And it's the same place I came with my mate Mountain Goat Dave, and we stopped off here for some fruit and a bit of drink. Got a welcoming party of some ducks on the bank. But as I say, I've just started to get some of the stuff out the top of the rucksack. Two fruit juices to get a bit of hydration, replace the calories, a lot of paddling, and the pots of peaches. And V's laying down underneath in the shade, underneath the weeping willow tree. Sit in the nice shade, bit of fresh air. So we just have finished our little pot of peaches and a fruit juice, and V has disembarked from double parking next to my canoe. And she's attempting, there's a cormorant, and she's going to see if she can get some footage of it virtually on that dead tree where there's some upright branches. You can sort of see just about there. There's the cormorant. I think he's going to stealthily try and go under the tree, and there she is taking some footage. And a nice relaxed sunny blue sky, a little bit of cloud, a little bit of fresh breeze, just the right conditions not to get hot and flustered when you're even when you're paddling just a little bit. You know, it can still be warm when you come out of the breeze, and it can be a bit humid, which it was actually earlier on when we started off. But it's just nice to have that fresh breeze, nice fresh air. I think V's trying to call me. Some duckies getting blinking excited. That was the one making all the blinking noise. Them two sort of went off, so I presume that one's who's your daddy? Probably that one by the sounds of it. So right, I'm going to embark onto the canoe, and we're going to take the route back downstream and just do it in one hit. Paddle past where we camped up and then further downstream to where we put in on the Friday afternoon. So we've come back to put in, unloaded some of the canoe, well, unloaded both the canoes basically. Got some kit strewn about, so there was plenty of space to shoot the canoe straight up, and then we're just lying them down here. They're all empty, ready to be deflated. So it's about 6:30 on Sunday evening. Really lovely if you could see from the sky. So it's going to be just a nice steady plod to deflate the canoes and roll them up, put them on the trolley, and then ready to make our way home. We've deflated the canoes and rolled them up, ready to put on the trolley. And V, my chauffeur, is already and waiting. Champing at the bit to get home, get her head down and scoff her face because she's now got into me force feeding her. I've subliminally, you're going to eat loads of food, 3-4 meals a day, loads of calories.
I'm easily persuaded.
So yeah, so we'll just say our farewells now. And so yeah, thanks for watching the vid. Me and V on our travels for the weekend. We had a really good time, and it was really good to take V out, and she's great company. Yeah. Chin wags, putting the world to right, all chats and all that sort of thing. So thanks for watching. Hope you sort of deemed some ideas from it, and also watch V's video, which will be relative to what we did the weekend, her one on her channel. Yes. So your channel, V?
It's called Wild Soul Vee.
Wild Soul Vee YouTube, and you'll see her one, and she's got loads of other additional things that she incorporated on her video. Yeah, with all bits of kit and all that sort of thing. So, and also scenery of wildlife, which she really got into. So say finally, as always, thanks for watching. Really appreciate it, Trish, and catch you in another video soon. Cheers, take care.
Bye for now.